everybody?
You're on.
All right, good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
And we welcome those of you who are maybe watching online. And anyway, it's a wild group today, those of you watching online. I don't know if the jail's left out early this morning or something, but anyway, we are in Proverbs chapter 4. We're going to start there in a moment. And what else? There was something I was going to share, but I can't remember, so it's okay. All right, Proverbs chapter 4. So today, take out lesson number 3 in your workbook, okay? And I want to encourage you and invite you to read ahead. I don't know what we're going to do today. It's 5 chapters. So we're going to start and we're going to quit at 12. Is that okay if we're done or not? The way of life and the way of death, okay? The path of life. And we're not going to go through much through these things, okay? Because we have so much volume of things. But let's read the hymn, okay? Everybody there? Session 3. Are you ready?
Yes.
Session 3. Ladies, would you please read verse 1 of the hymn? Fellas, please. It is the power of God to save from sin and Satan and the grave. It works the faith which firmly clings to all the treasures which it brings. All of us, may we in faith its tidings learn, nor thanklessly its blessings spurn. Faith its truth confess. Praise the Lord. All right, let's pray the prayer together, please. Gracious Father, 2 ways stretch out before us each day, the way of life and the way of death. Grant us discerning eyes, a wise heart, obedient feet, so that we may joyfully follow in your footsteps. We pray this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. All right, we're going to start with Proverbs chapter 4. Would you turn to it, please? All right. And the title of is Wisdom is Supreme. And as I begin reading, I think we're going to go through some things as I read. So let me just say this. Almighty God stands behind these chapters, okay, as we talk about wisdom. Let me begin. Listen, my sons, to a father's instruction. Pay attention and gain understanding. I give you sound learning, so do not forsake my teaching. Now notice how it changes here. When I was a boy in my father's house. Who's writing this? Solomon. So who's he talking about?
David.
His father David. Yes. He's talking about when I was a boy in my father's house. By the way, that wasn't much of a house. Oh, it was a mansion. But you know anything about David's house? There were people that, never mind. There were people there from all over the world. And Solomon's house wasn't much better. We'll come to that. When I was a boy in my father's house, still tender and an only child of my mother, he taught me and said, lay hold of my words with all your heart. Keep my commands and you will live. Get wisdom, get understanding. Do not forget my words or swerve from them. Do not forsake wisdom and she will protect you. Notice wisdom is in the feminine voice, yes. Love her and she will watch over you. Wisdom is supreme, therefore get wisdom. Would you highlight that, circle that little word? You can mark up your Bible, it's okay. Get wisdom. And that teaches us what? Wisdom can be found. Yeah, it's there. It can be found. But there you have to be what? Looking for it, you betcha. Let's go on. Though it costs all you have, get understanding. Esteem her, and she will exalt you. Embrace her, she will honor you. She will set a garland of grace on your head and present you with a crown of splendor. Listen, my son, and accept what I say, and the years of your life will be many. I guide you in the way of wisdom, lead you along straight paths. When you walk, your steps will not be hampered. When you run, you will not stumble. Hold on to instruction and do not let it go. Guard it well, for it is your life. Okay, let's pause there for a moment. What do I want to share? Listen, my son, fidelity to wisdom means fidelity to Almighty God. Okay, behind wisdom stands our Father in heaven. He is the giver of all wisdom, and he gives that wisdom to us in this chapter through our Marlene, that door's not closed. He gives it through our parents. All right, let me ask a question. How many of you remember being taught wisdom by your parents? Not many hands are going up. How many of you remember being taught purposely wisdom by your parents? Okay, yeah, all right. You remember? You don't know. You don't remember. It's okay. You don't have to remember. Do you remember what they taught you? You remember what they taught you? What did they tell you? One thing. Oh, and the proverb of the world. There you go. Financial proverb. How about do what I say or not do as I do? Oh, no, that doesn't say that. Do as I say. Yes, I remember my father was a great giver of wisdom. Well, he knew his Old Testament, read his Hebrew, but he focused on wisdom. And one of the things I learned about wisdom is it has a calming effect upon you. Have you ever noticed that? Calming effect, because if you're living with wisdom, you're not a nut all over the place, where everything bothers you and you're all scatterbrained. Oh, that's a good term. Oh, let's write that down. You don't want to be scatterbrained, which means you don't know what's going on and you have no concept of how to manage things. Wisdom gives you a settled spirit, correct? Wisdom takes away your angst. Who said angst? Somebody said angst? Anchor. Oh, an anchor, yes. Gives you an anchor. All right. A boy in my father's house. Solomon about his father David. My father taught me, look at verse 7. Oh, verse 7. Wisdom is supreme. You ought to write down somewhere. It is to be esteemed and embraced. So embrace wisdom. When you embrace wisdom, what does that mean? You make it personal and a part of your life, okay? Notice verse 14, don't set your foot on the path of the wicked. That is a major theme in the book of Proverbs, following a path. How many of you remember following a path, not literally, but figuratively in your life? I followed a path from early on. Anybody here else followed a path?
In my occupation.
Okay, from early on, you were following the path to become a teacher. Okay, anybody else?
Well, being a mother, you have to follow the path to raise those children up.
Okay, I guess I don't think of that as a path, but that's okay. Okay, all right. Anybody else? Who had their hand up over here? Yeah. In the science field. Is that when you blew up the first house you lived in? Okay. No, anybody else that you were on a path to something, a path to school, a path to college, a path? Well, I remember one person said, yes, I was on a path to find a husband. All right, path to get out of the house and find a husband. He was my, what was that? I don't know who said that, but I thought that was funny. All right, don't set your foot on the path of the wicked, all right? So you got to walk the walk if you're going to talk the talk. By the way, didn't I preach on that Sunday? I think I did. Or was that this coming? Yeah, that, oh, words, hollow piety don't matter much, right? It's easy to talk religious, but you have to walk the walk. And I'm afraid we have a lot of that in American culture. We talk the talk, but very little deep religious commitment to the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm afraid that's one of our problems. All right. The path of the wicked versus the verse 18, the path of righteous, of the righteousness. Pay attention to what I say. Where are we? What verse are we in? Oh, okay. Let's go back to chapter 4. Let me read on. Verse 14, do not set your foot on the path of the wicked or walk in the way of evil men. Avoid it. Don't travel on it. I'm in verse 16. For they cannot sleep till they do evil. They are robbed of slumber till they make someone fall, eat the bread of wickedness, and drink the wine of violence. The path of righteousness is like the first gleam of dawn. But the way of the wicked is like deep darkness. They do not know what makes them stumble. No, what verbiage, what imagery, huh? My son, pay attention to what I say. Listen closely to my words. Don't let them out of your sight. Keep them where? In your heart. Heart is a word that we come upon, not real often, but in the book. What would you say is your heart? Soul is so ambiguous. Your heart is what? Obviously it's a reference to the physical organ, but your heart is?
It's the lifeline. It's what keeps you going.
Well, or it's who you are. It's what is most dear to you, your foundation. Let's use the word foundation. All right. Verse 21, do not let them out of your sight, my words. They are life to those who find them and health to a man's whole body. Verse 23, above all else, you should highlight this, underline it, guard your heart, for it is the wellspring of life. Put away perversity from your mouth. Keep corrupt talk far from your lips. I think we talked about this 2 weeks ago. Have you noticed something about our culture? You can identify people, personalities, people, by their verbiage. No? You can, if there's a lot of curse words, that's their world. No, right? I mean, all of us use them once in a while. I understand that because, you know, but if you met people that's their verbiage, that is their life. How would you like to live with those words in your mind, on your lips, and in your heart? Think about that. I'm living with those words. You know, whatever they are, the evil words. What, Marlene?
This last week, I have heard two politicians drop F-bombs.
All right. Let's go to day two. We're going to Proverbs chapter 5. Now, I want you to turn, keep your hand at Proverbs 5. Go to, where is it? 1 Kings 11. Go to 1 Kings 11. 1st, 2nd Samuel, 1st, 2nd Kings. 1 Kings 11. It's to the left. Yeah, somebody help. 1 Kings 11. Verse 1. Okay, I don't remember this, but this is huge. In my estimation, this is huge. All right, don't read it yet. Wait till everybody's there. Don't go ahead, you know. All right, let me read it out loud. 1 Kings 11, are you there? Oh, come on, people. Oh, my gosh. Hey, you want to help her out back there? Somebody want to help her out? Daryl, Kropke, help them out. Help those ladies out around you. All right, here we go. King Solomon. Are you with me? King Solomon loved many foreign women besides Pharaoh's daughters, Moabites, Ammonites, Edomites, Sidonites, and Hittites. I wonder where the Shabubites were. They were from nations about which the Lord had told the Israelites, you must not intermarry with them, because they will surely turn your hearts after their gods. Nevertheless, Solomon held fast to them in love. He had 700 wives of royal birth, 300 concubines. His wives led him astray. As Solomon grew old, his wives turned his heart after other gods, and his heart was not fully devoted to the Lord his God, as the heart of David his father had been. Look at verse 6. So Solomon did evil in the eyes of the Lord. He did not follow the Lord completely, as David his father had done. Turn back to Proverbs chapter 5. That gives you a clue into Solomon's life as the author of this. Okay? And maybe that's why we have so much about women in the book of Proverbs. Seriously, I'm serious. I think he didn't totally turn away from the Lord, but he lived a divided life. Okay? And if I'm reading this correctly, Solomon had a weakness for sex. Let's just say it. He had a weakness for sex with numerous women. Okay? Have you ever thought of the old boy that way? I never have so much. But all that. And as a result, all these women from foreign nations with their foreign gods. Yes. Yes, and I had sex with her, so I guess I gotta kind of pay attention to her gods. Wow. So, I think there's a lot of sex in the book of Proverbs, and you need to understand why. Because I think if he wrote this at an older time, yes. Okay, so what are we in? Chapter 5, yeah. My son, pay attention to my wisdom. Listen well to my words of insight, that you may maintain discretion. Your lips may preserve knowledge, for the lips of an adulteress drip honey. Her speech is smoother than oil. Maybe he experienced that numerous times. In the end, she's bitter as gall, double-edged sword. Her feet go down to death. Her steps led straight to the grave. She gives no thought to the way of life. Her paths are crooked, but she knows it not. Now then, my sons, listen to me. Don't turn aside from what I say. Keep to a path far from her. Okay? This is not a reference to all women. All right? Ladies, I don't want you to be offended today. But don't think Solomon is putting all of you in the same basket. Okay? All right? So these are women of his past from all those countries. Keep to a path far from her. He should have what? Stayed away from them. Do not go near the door of her house, lest you give your best strength to others, your ears to the one who is cruel. Let strangers feast on your wealth. Ooh, what is that? Old Solomon, by dealing with all these foreign women, lost a whole bunch of wealth, all right? Your toil, enrich another man's house. Woo! At the end of your life, you will groan when your flesh and body are spent. You will say, how I hated discipline, how my heart spurned correction. I would not obey my teachers or listen to instructors. I have come to the brink of ruin in the midst of the whole assembly. All right? Now, you understand this from Solomon's perspective. Everybody, it's very important. We just don't pull this out of the air. Okay? drink water from your own cistern. This is imagery to your wife, faithful to your wife, running water from your own well. Should your springs overflow in the streets, your streams of water in the public squares, let them be yours alone, never to be shared with strangers. May your fountain be blessed. May you rejoice in the wife of your youth, a loving doe, a graceful deer. May her breast satisfy you always. May you ever be captivated by her love. Why be captivated, my son, to an adulteress? Why embrace the bosom of another man's wife? And obviously, Solomon practiced that. Probably not once, twice, but numerous times. The evil deeds of a wicked man ensnare him. The cords of sin hold him fast. He'll die for lack of discipline, lest led astray by his own great stupid foolishness. Because he was a blank fool. Right? Yeah. Why didn't God pick a better guy? Oh. I don't either. All right. All right, let's go to through the notes here. Is there anything I want to share with you on from my notes? Not really. Let me go through these things, my notes. By the way, I have my notes that I do on my own study, and that's what I'm giving you. My lips of the strange woman dominates this chapter. And when you read his past, you understand it. Drink water from your own cistern. Rejoice in the wife of your youth. In other words, be faithful to the one woman you fell in love with. Yeah. Captivated by another man's wife, a man's ways. Oh, look at verse 21. You should highlight this. A man's ways are in full view of the Lord. Everybody should highlight that. Ladies, that's true of you too. You're not off the hook on this, girls. Right? It's not just us. Verse 21, highlight it, mark it. In other words, you can't what? You can't hide from God. He knows what's going on. Okay? You can hide from your parents. You can hide from other people. But God knows. By the way, that's always a good reminder, isn't it? When you're tempted to sin, and you know you can get away with it, hopefully your conscience says, God knows. Right? I mean, seriously. By the way, even to have that as part of your consciousness is a sign of wisdom. Is it getting warm in here? Okay. So everybody understand that? All right? God is always watching. A man's ways are in full view of God. Trust in the Lord. Learn divine wisdom. To learn it requires, I don't know where I got this, careful listening. Oh, and here's a good. To have wisdom, you have to be open to what?
Disruption.
What? Correction. I got that written down right here on my page. You have to be open to correction and discipline. Who said that? You guys are good. You should teach this. Yes, write this down. Wisdom requires an openness to correction and discipline. Are you guys open to correction? I think the older we get, the less open we are. You know why? We get used to our ways. And then we throw this out. Well, that's just the way I am. That doesn't work so well in a marriage, does it? That's just the way I am. Oh, my gosh. You better get used to it, baby. I'm going out with other women every Friday night, woman. Yeah, that's my night to howl. That's just the way it is, right? That's when she pulls out the gun, right, Stephen? She pulls out the gun and points and shoots you in bed and says, I don't know, he must have killed himself. Well, seriously, right? You got to be able to be corrected at an old age. And by the way, it's good to have someone who can correct you. Now, think about your own life. I don't want you to say anything. But I've experienced this lately with someone. I never thought it would come from. But where someone gives you a perspective that you all of a sudden you see yourself and you realize, yeah, that's true. I got to change. Let me share this with you. I had to be with Pastor Barker out at, you know, out there. He and I drove together to Palm Springs for pastors. So we were 3 hours in the car. So we were talking about what's happening in churches. And I said something like, you know, I'm really mourning. M-O-U-R-N-I-N-G. Mourning what's happened to our church. I told you we lost over half of our congregation in the last 4 or 5 years. Moving away, death, you know, the COVID thing, the fallout from COVID. That's the word. And you know what he said to me? He said, yeah, you are like you. I noticed that about you. You are mourning. And you know, ever since I heard that, that has been good for me. Because it woke me up. I knew there was something there. And it's like, okay, now I got to get past that. Yeah. And you know, it's good to have someone. And that's true. By the way, churches are mourning too. Did you know that? People are mourning in churches. And we're blessed. I thank God for as good as we have it. Many churches are adult. And the churches are mourning. The real lay people are mourning and pastors. But anyway, it's good to have someone who corrects you. Usually it's your spouse, right? Huh? A good spouse or an adult child. Oh, that's good. And how many anybody got an adult child who's a corrector? All right. Oh, yeah. All right. Good. That's good. Good. And you got each other, right, girls? Huh? You have any weapons in the house? You ought to get rid of them. Oh, no. The Michiganders. Okay, let's move on. Where are we going? Chapter what? 7. No, 6. Oh, gosh, we're never going to make it. Warnings against folly. My son, if you put up security for your neighbor. Okay, I got to find my notes. Hang on a minute, people. Where is it? Oh, here it is. If you put up security for your neighbor, if you have struck hands and pledged for another, if you've been trapped by what you said and snared by the words of your mouth, do this to free yourself. Since you have fallen into your neighbor's hands, go and humble yourself, press your plea, allow no sleep to your eyes, no slumber. Free yourself like a gazelle from the hand of the hunter, like a bird from the snare of the fowler. What is this in the first 5 verses? Anybody got a note? What I have is providing some financial backing for someone in debt. Or you've promised to help somebody and you realize this is not a good thing. You ever done that? You said you would do something and you realized this is not right. This is not good. I shouldn't do that. So the point is, go and admit you were wrong. Right away, all right? Okay? That's the point. So if you screw up, if you make a mistake, if you promise somebody something, you got to have the courage to say, listen, I'm sorry, and make peace with it, right? Do what's right, but make peace with it and settle it, correct? I think so. That's true in business, right? Yeah. Okay. Because we all make mistakes. All right, let's go on. Humble yourself. Let's go on verses 6 to 11. Now, this is interesting. Go to the ant, you sluggard. Totally different. Consider its ways. Be wise. He has no commander or overseer or ruler. Yet the ant stores its provisions in summer, gathers its food at harvest. How long will you lie there, you sluggard? When will you get up from your sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the arms to rest? Poverty will come on you like a bandit. Scarcity will like an armed man. So what is this all about?
Laziness.
Being lazy, a warning against laziness. And he uses the example of the ant. Yeah, look at the ant. Look at how busy as the ants are. Nobody's looking out pushing him, right? So get up. You know anybody in your life who is a sluggard? Huh? You know sluggards? Yeah, and really, one of the problems with sluggards is they... I'm not sure they know that they're a sluggard. I think they've gotten so used to that way of life, that's what I do, you know. So my wife takes care of me. Huh? Huh? Yeah. Expect others to take care of me. Yeah.
Isn't he also saying, "Wake up and fly right"?
I guess, but I don't know. You got that in your book? Well, maybe, but I think this is on laziness. Yeah. Well, same thing. Wake up and fly right. Yeah. You know, would you go out and get a job? Huh? You ever say that to any of your kids? I think you need to go get a job. Some people are very industrious, aren't they? Those of us who come from a certain nationality have an industrial side to us, correct? Yes? How many of you were raised on the farm? Some of you were on the farm. On the farm. You weren't raised on the farm in Northridge? Were you? Okay. Yeah. You were put to work, weren't you? Right away. Yep. Huh? You had to. Yeah. It didn't matter. You had charge of the chickens or had to go pick eggs or whatever you had to do, right? Yeah. By the way, rural America has a lot to teach us living in the cities. Independence, management, love for nature, the blessing of nature, growing things. All right. A little more sleep. Lazy bones cannot escape the threat of poverty. All right, verse 12. Where are we? Where are we? What chapter? Oh. All right, I'm sorry. A scoundrel and villain who goes about with a corrupt mouth, who winks with his eye. Notice the body parts here. Mouth winks with his eye, signals with his feet, motions with his fingers, plots evil with deceit in his heart, always stirs up dissension. Therefore, disaster will overtake him in an instant. He will suddenly only be destroyed without remedy. This is another new topic, right? These are people who are scoundrels and villains, all right? Yeah, and they plan. They're always manipulating. They're always doing something stupid, right? Huh? Plotting. They're always plotting. And there are those people, are there not?
Yes.
And sometimes we find them at work, correct? They're always plotting the death of the pastor. You know, that was a foolish thing to say because it could happen sooner than later now. Anyway, the scoundrel. Notice the body parts, okay? Let's move on. Oh, I love the next section. Verse 16. Six things the Lord hates. Wow. Seven are detestable. Notice the list? You should underline these. Haughty eyes, a lying tongue, hands that shed innocent blood, heart that devises wicked schemes, feet that are quick to rush to evil, a false witness, a man who stirs up dissension among his brothers. Put that's a whole new topic. Yeah, seven things. And notice who hates it. The Lord hates it. Now, if anybody here has one of those, you ought to get rid of it. Like today. And if you don't, praise God. Haughty eyes. I'm better than you. I know better than you. I'm smarter than you. I know better. See, I'm correct. All right? Hands that shed innocent blood, wicked schemes, quick to rush into evil. False witness. A false witness who throws out lies. You ever met anybody like that? They throw out lies, and they know that. And to stir up what? Dissension, right? To stir up conflict. Yeah. You ever have any girlfriends like that or boyfriends like that? Huh? A man who stirs up dissension among his brothers. All right. Are we done here? Okay. Here's the last section is the formation of moral character. All right. This is, again, warning against adultery. I'm not going to read this. Warnings against adultery, formation, parents' instruction. She is already married, the wife of a neighbor. Immoral woman, wayward wife. Okay? So again, this goes, again, you have to understand all of this. Doesn't mean that all women are bad. My gosh, you know. Don't think that. This is going back to Solomon again. Let's go to chapter 7. Warnings against the adulteress. Oh, here we have another one. Oh, my. Okay, this is the last of the parental instructions. All right, my son. Notice the words. Keep my words. No, you should underline these. Store up my commands where? Within you. Keep my commands and you will live. Guard my teachings as the, circle this one, apple of your eye. What is the apple of your eye? Oh, that's a Jewish thing, isn't it? That's a Jewish ministry, the apple of his eye ministry. That's down in L.A. Yes, that's a apple of his eye. Yeah, I don't know if that's still functioning. By the way, I want to share something with you. Bind them on your fingers, write them on your tablets, say you are my, to wisdom, you're my sister. Call understanding your kinsman. They will keep you from the adulteress, from the wayward wife and her seductive words. Now here we have, in verse 6, here we have a young, simple youth, okay? And the emphasis is on adultery and sexual excess, okay? All right, so notice setting the scene, all right? At the window of my mouth, of my house, oh my God. At the window of my house, I looked out through the lattice, and there I saw among the simple, among the young men, a youth who lacked judgment. So that's the setting. He's looking out, and here you see these bunch of young guys, and there's a special guy who's especially what? Especially stupid. Especially, not too bright, all right? No. Let's just say that. That doesn't mean he's dumb, but he's just simple, all right? Who lacked judgment. So he's going down to the street corner near her corner, walking along the direction of her house at twilight as the day was fading, as the dark of the night set in. So he goes to the prostitute's house. Okay, everybody there? Then out came a woman to meet him, dressed like a prostitute. Crafty hair. You didn't know prostitutes were in the Bible, did you? Oh, they're in all over. She is loud, and Jesus even dealt with them. She's just not nice and sweet. She's loud and defiant. Her feet never stay at home. Isn't this crazy? Now, she isn't just a sweet little old thing. She's loud and defiant. She's mouthy. Her feet never stay home. She's in the street. She's in the squares. Every corner she lurks. She took hold of this. That's a young guy. The simple guy, and kissed him with a brazen face. She said, I have fellowship offerings at home. Today I fulfilled my vows. I'm not sure what that means. I couldn't figure it out. So I came out to meet you, she says. I looked for you and have found you. I've covered my bed with colored linens from Egypt. I've perfumed my bed with myrrh, aloes, and cinnamon. Come, let's drink deep love till morning. Let's enjoy ourselves. My husband's not at home. He's gone on a long journey. He took his purse filled with money and will not be home till full moon. With persuasive words, she led him astray. She seduced him with her smooth. At once, all at once, he followed her. Look at this one, like an ox to the slaughter. You just got to laugh at this imagery, but it's so dumb, but it's real too. Oh, yeah. She's like a deer stepping into a noose till an arrow pierces his liver, like a bird darting into a snare, little knowing it will cost him his life. So there's the scenario. We laugh about it, but it's a picture of a simple guy who gets pulled away by someone who leads him astray. Okay, now, the initial reference, of course, is to a prostitute, right? Yeah. But let's have a little deeper. What's a deeper?
Soap operas.
Oh, yeah. But let's have a little deeper, deeper level than simple prostitute. It's foolishness. It's the adulterous foolishness that leads you away and gives you all these nice things of promise. You know, now convert all this language to foolishness and you see how what? Seductive foolishness is. And if you're simple and if you're not alert to the seduction of foolishness, you will fall prey. Everybody understand that? So behind this kind of funny scenario is this, I think, this deeper meaning of don't be like this dumb kid and be aware of what's going on around you, right? Did your parents teach you that when you were young? You know, let me tell you my story. I don't know if I ever told you this. I of course, went to the juvenile hall when I was 14. And I had to take the bus from Milwaukee to Buffalo. Anybody, you know that route on Interstate 90? To go home for Christmas. I was in the juvie hall in Milwaukee. And I had to go through the Chicago Bus Depot. Anybody ever been in the Chicago Bus Depot? None of you have. If you would have, you would remember it. No. Oh, no, I took the bus from Milwaukee to Chicago. They drive, take you there. You know who fills the bus depot in Chicago? Pickpockets. And probably prostitutes. When you're 14 years old and I had my suit on underneath my winter coat in December going home, I was, and my suitcase, I was like this simple kid. I was waiting to be picked and robbed. My father, in his wisdom, told me two things. He said, don't be alone on the bus or on in the place, and put your money in your pocket, in your suit pocket, and put a safety, and not in your pants, and put a safety pin in there so they don't steal it. And that I told my, and that's one of the wisest things. But, you know, I remember looking around, and there were some dicey look. We got somebody here, Marlene. There were some dicey looking women sitting in the Chicago Bus Depot. Okay. Some spicy. Did I say spicy or dicey? All right. Where are we? Are we done now? Finish it out. Verse 24. Now then, my sons, listen to me. Pay attention. Do not let your heart to her turn to her ways or stray to her paths. Many are the victims she has brought down. Her slain are a mighty throng. Her house is a highway to the grave, leading down to the chambers of death. I propose to you that he's talking about folly there, foolishness, not the woman so much. Okay? So everybody see the double meanings in this? All right, let's go to chapter 8. All right, highway to the grave. Don't you like that? Highway to heaven, highway to the death. All right, wisdom's call. We only have to go to 21. Thank you, Jesus. All right. Does not wisdom call out? Does not understanding raise her voice? On the heights along the way where the paths meet, she takes her stand. Beside the gates leading into the city, at the entrances, she cries aloud. To you, O men, I call out. I raise my voice to all mankind. You who are simple, gain prudence. You who are foolish, gain understanding. Listen, for I have worthy things to say. Oh, I open my lips to speak what is right. My mouth speaks what is true. My lips detest wickedness. All the words of my mouth are just. None of them is crooked, perverse. To the discerning, all of them are right. That's the discerning ones. All of my words are right. They are faultless to those who have knowledge. Choose my instruction instead of silver, knowledge rather than gold. Wisdom is more precious than rubies. Nothing you desire can compare with her. All right. So this is wisdom's call. To all people, not just fools. So the point of this is wisdom calls out. Wisdom calls out to us. How does wisdom call out to us? Well, how about, well, through parents, number one, friends, people, older people that we learn from, that we gather some. Did you ever have somebody in your life who was sort of the person who gave you guidance and direction when you were young? You did. Okay, who? You don't have to tell us who it was. Was it a parent?
No, it was a supervisor.
Oh, a supervisor at the phone company. Okay, yeah. There you go.
When I was little, I thought, well, okay, I didn't know why we would be interested to watch us. When I got older, I just
She must have read that passage in Proverbs, the Lord sees all that you do. Good. Yeah, it's good to have that, right? I mean, that's important. Someone who speaks the wisdom, it's there. Pity the kid who has nobody to give him guidance and understanding. You know, and really, as parents, it's our job to correct our... Pity the child who isn't corrected, who isn't told that's wrong, or doing right and wrong. Sure, yeah, say, okay, that's sixth sense we call that, that something's not right, yeah. I don't know if we all have that. But some have it more profound than others. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Wisdom's call. Notice she, notice the she. No private, whatever that is. Not private. All right. She cries out. Wisdom cries out. She raises her voice. Her audience has no limits. She even comes, speaks to fools. Anyone who will listen. Yeah. It's wisdom speaks out, but you have to have the ears and the mind to listen. And not just to listen, but then to apply it. All right. Choose my instruction instead of silver. Verses 6 to 11. Is the value she stands for. All right, let's go on to the last section. I, wisdom. Notice all the different words for this. I, wisdom, dwell together with prudence. I possess knowledge, discretion. To fear the Lord is to hate evil. I hate pride, arrogance, evil behavior, perverse speech. Look at the list. Let's just stop there for a moment. Wisdom has prudence, discretion, and fear of the Lord, which means you hate what is evil. Okay? I hate pride and arrogance. Now, let's talk about that. So it's not an indifference to it, evil, right? It's not indifference to pride and arrogance, but you hate it. Which means we have to fight it, correct? Don't you hate the know-it-all?
Oh, yeah.
And especially those who make it up as they go.
Yeah.
Huh? Then you find out, yeah, as time goes on. You didn't know what you were saying, all right? Look, I hate pride, evil behavior, and perverse speech. Perverse speech. I'm trying to think of that. People I've known with perverse speech. They make stuff up, they're causing trouble among people. That happens in families, doesn't it? Huh?
Politicians.
Yeah, the media maybe, I don't know. You know, how you speak and what you say is important, right? The best is to be honest, and if you make a mistake, what do? Admit it, yeah. And learn from it, correct? Yeah, and change your behavior. We're not always that good at that, changing our behavior. But, and so, by the way, sometimes we have habits of which we are unaware that are not good. Like drinking. drugs. Think about that. You know, which we are, people are unaware. Bad habits. Watching shows we shouldn't be watching on TV. All right, where are we? Okay, verse 14. Counsel and sound judgment are mine. I have understanding and power. By me, kings reign. Rulers make laws that are just. Princes govern. Nobles rule on earth. I love those who love me. This is wisdom talking. Those who seek me find me. With me are riches, honor, enduring wealth, and prosperity. My fruit, what I produce, is better than gold. What I yield surpasses choice silver. I walk in the way of righteousness along the paths of justice, bestowing the wealth on those who love me and making their treasures full. All right, any last words? Notice in verse 12, wisdom equals prudence, knowledge, discretion, counsel, and sound judgment. Let's talk about sound judgment for a moment. When you're looking for advice, how do you go about that?
Well, hopefully it's someone who has knowledge of the issue.
Okay.
I find someone trust.
Trustworthy. Okay, anybody else? How about going to more than one person? Okay, I have a proverb for you, and just came to mind. I wanted to talk about it. When you have to make a decision and you're not sure what to do, what do you do?
Pray.
Well, okay, pray. That's good. Okay. All right. I got two things. Until you're sure, you do nothing. Thank you. If you don't know, you do nothing. One of the things I learned early on is when you have decisions, you make lists, pros and cons, and you put it on the wall or on the refrigerator, and you look at it and think about it, pray about it, you add to it, you cross things off. And I did that when I had calls. You know, I would always visit because, you know, you got to give the honor to the congregation if they call. And when you visit, you always go with an open mind. And I would always write things down, pros and cons. And two things, and the reason I'm telling you this, I just told a young pastor this at the conference. And I said, because he gets calls a lot. He's a good guy. I said, your head and your heart have to line up. In other words, intellectually, you got to say, okay, I should go or I should not go. And your heart, emotionally, should say, I should go or not go. And before I came here, I had a lot of calls in Iowa and Minnesota. And if it didn't line up, and I don't know who taught me that. I think my father did, or I don't know, somebody. But that was good advice. Because a lot of preachers go for the wrong reasons. And then they go from one trouble to a next. And they go in, they wonder why the heck is wrong. Yeah, they go from church to church. And foolish. And then there are those who manipulate too. There's lay people who manipulate. I've met those along the way too. Late in the calling process, lay people's problem is they try to manipulate to get what they want. And whenever lay people manipulate the process, like an officer or chairman of the congregation, you know, pushes somebody through, as opposed to the folks voting. By the way we select votes on calling pastors, I think, is marvelous. Because the whole congregation gets to vote their conscience. Yay or nay, right? Okay. But I've seen where some lay people manipulate the process and it always ends badly.
Because it's
manipulated, yeah. So I want to give that advice to you guys. If you have a decision, and you know, as you get older, you got to make decisions, right? I know one of them is, you know, do I stay in my house or do I go to some facility? By the way, let me just say to you, the longer you can stay in your home, the better off. Bring help in. Amen?
Amen?
Do all of you say amen?
Amen.
Or not? Anybody want to disagree with me? Okay. And by the way, you know who you have to tell that to?
Your kids.
I'm sorry, but I don't want you to offend anybody online. I've seen so many times where older people are moved to away from everybody they know, all of their associations, all their friends, all their stuff that filled their life, popped in a place hundreds, if not thousands of miles away, and they're miserable and nobody visits them. And the kids moved them there because, well, they're closer to us. Yeah. And after six, I know we have. So let me just warn you folks and those who are watching, older people, God bless you. Stay in your home as long as you can. Get help to come in two, 3 hours a day. That's okay. So that's all you need. And if it gets more. Okay? But yeah, those are tough decisions, right? I mean, they are life decisions. Any other decisions? Okay. Last thing. Can we go on for a couple more minutes?
Yeah.
So here's my question. What is your weakness? What is your weakness? Or what are your weaknesses? I want you to write this down. Don't look at anybody next to you. Okay? I got a list. Just put two things down. What are your weaknesses in life? Okay? But write them down. Two of them. Be honest with yourself. Nobody has to know it. I don't want to know it. What are you weak? What's a weakness? That, like, you know, that you can become foolish. No, I'm not talking chocolate. No. Yeah. All right, I give you half a minute because, you know, silence is a bad thing. Okay. All right. What's your weakness? I have a list here of a number of them. And I got these from the staff in the church because they have a lot of weaknesses. You can decide which of them came from the two, each one of them. I know. All right, how about arrogance? That's a weakness, isn't it? Know-it-all. I know better than you. A know-it-all, arrogance. Talk too much. How about that for a weakness? You just talk too much, you know? It'll give it a rest, right? How about sex? That's going to be a weakness. Solomon had that one, didn't he? How about money? Money. So either the love thereof, the hoarding of it, or the spending of it can be on both ways. Here's one which is quite popular. It's me, myself, and I. It's all about me, what I want. Yeah, I mean, some of us have that weakness. We, you know, I can think of people I've known, it's all what I want. And by the way, their verbiage, if you ever know, verbiage says a lot, because in a discussion it always reverts to me. Yeah. Okay.
I don't have enough trust in myself to think that I can do things, and I can't do that, and I really, when you're path to do it, you find out you can.
Okay. All right. Anyway, let me finish my list. So self, me, judgment, judgmental, critical of everything. I find fault. You know, it's easy to find fault with some of you. That, I think that came from one of the staff members. Fearful of things. Always living in fear. That's a terrible way to live. How about drugs and alcohol? That can be a weakness. How about, here's a good one. Jumping to conclusions. There's no one in the office like that. Jumping to conclusions, thinking the worst.
That's how we get our exercise.
And the last one I got is gluttony. Gluttony. So what is your weakness? I think it's important from a personal level that each of us individually identify our own weaknesses and put them on paper. And think about it and be aware of that. That will help you what? Overcome your weakness. And it's good to have sort of a buddy who can hit you in the side and say, you're a knucklehead, cut it out. Right? Yeah, it's good to have somebody. And pity the person who doesn't have that, you know? Anyway. All right, are we done? I'm exhausted. All right, next week. What's next week's lesson? Look it up quick, somebody. Next week is chapter, it's a short one. It's 8 and 9, I think. Yeah, it's short, okay? I was going to share something. What was that? 8 and 9. Mara, anything? Huh? Oh, the window, yeah. Oh, and the circuit. Last night we had a circuit gathering of circuits 3 and 4, the San Fernando Valley. We had 31 people there to talk about beginning new faith communities. Not congregations necessarily, but faith communities in our area. And we had 8 churches, 31 people, which was fantastic. And remember the old Circuit 3 Mission Society? Anybody remember that? That was very active back in the 90s and the early 2000s. Just faded away. So it's in the bulletin. We need to pray for that, that we as churches look at new faith communities. And if you have any ideas, give them to me, okay? Give them to me. New faith communities. And what was the other one, Mar? Oh, the windows. Some of you are aware, anybody aware that we had vandalism at our church on Monday night. Two stones this big were thrown through the windows in the sanctuary. And have we ever had that before? I don't remember in my time. At Pilgrim. Have we had that? I don't think so. So anyway, we don't know what that was all about. So. Yes. Yeah. Where we have the boulders, those rocks, you know, they're not boulders, but so we're gonna get rid of those, Mar? What?
Do you want to mention the email from Penny that I got?
That's of the things they're building, right? Yeah, if you want to look at that building.
I typed out the list. All the information
is on that sheet. Okay. Where'd you get this?
I got it. City. My neighbor put a thing in my mailbox, and then I saw it on Channel 5 yesterday. So
this is on new high-rise buildings in residential neighborhoods.
It's on Channel 5's website.
Yeah. Isn't that amazing?
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, let's pray. Dear Father in heaven, give us wisdom. The best wisdom we have is to know Jesus as our Savior, and help us to have that wisdom of faith. Dear Lord, bless our time together and help us to be a blessing to one another, to deal with our weaknesses, but also, dear Lord, to celebrate our strengths and to have the fellowship that we have in this congregation with one another, even with struggles and difficulties, dear Lord. We thank you for the fellowship we have and the wisdom we gain together. Remind us, dear Lord, that faith is always personal, but it's never solitary. Our life of faith is always with others. In Jesus' name, amen. Goodbye, everybody. Hasta la vista. You like that? Faith is personal, but not